Squint.
We're just over a week away from a test series that will define how the 37 players selected for the 2021 British and Irish Lions are remembered. These players are two wins away from becoming immortalised in rugby history. They're two wins away from becoming not just Lions, the highest achievement any individual in Britain and Ireland can achieve in rugby, but winning Lions, victorious Lions. They enter the hallowed halls adorned by the players who pulled it off in 1974, 1997, and then two tours from right back when Alan Wynne-Jones was still in nursery. For all the flashy attack we've seen so far, it's a test series that will be built on what either team can do without the ball. The Lions are taking on the best defence in the world and are coached by a guy who made a serious go at taking an underdog team all the way in World Cups 2011 and 19 by building a side on how many tackles they can make. We're going to spend so much of the month ooing and aahing at Cheslin Colby and Josh Adams' attempts to out-ridiculous each other's try-scoring heroics, but this is a series that's going to be all about how you stop the opposition, how you twist and shake their attempts to do the same. We know how the Springboks are going to defend. Nothing in that area has changed since the World Cup in their hit out against Georgia, but the Lions are a new team, a team where those defensive pieces are still being slotted into place. So, how are the Lions currently defending, and how are they going to adapt to face the Springboks based on the four whole games we've now seen them play on tour? Well, trying to explain how the Lions are defending might be the most difficult thing I've had to do on this channel today, and I once tried to convince the world George Ford is the best 10 out there. It's not because the Lions are doing anything because tell you what, right, here's a clip from the 2013 Greta Gerwig movie, Frances Ha, I think about sums it up.
What do you do?
It's kind of hard to explain.
Because what you do is complicated?
Because I don't really do it.
It's not that the Lions' defense is complicated. It's that the Lions have got to game four on tour without really having had to defend. The Lions have dominated not just the scoreboard, but territory and possession in all three games out in South Africa so far. The second test against the Sharks saw them concede five tries, but four of them were breakaways or against the run of play. That doesn't tell us the Lions' defence is poor, it tells us the Lions are making errors on attack. Elliot Daly here shows experimental dick finger surgery is irreversible, and in response, the Sharks show great hands, which is a brand new sentence, and sprint it in. Gareth Davis has seen Ali Price put himself very much in test contention, and so decides to do his best impression of the guy, gifting his opposite number a try. Murray heard it too and tries to pull something else from the...
Ali! Stop for fuck's sake!
Fuck off, Ali!
...playbook and, well...
Cock is in!
Unfortunate. Bigger lobs a pass at Van der Merwe's ankles, which in fairness is about the height of most human shoulders, and the Sharks once again break away extremely well and score. The Lions won't gift South Africa four tries from overplaying in big games. The attack is going to tighten up both in ideas and execution so much by the time we get there. But with four whole games under the belt now, and these errors still so evident, there is a bit of danger that maybe there will be one of these mistakes the Box could exploit, which would swing a game as tight as those tests are currently likely to be. And most of the other tries conceded have also come from individual defensive errors rather than the team breaking them down. Rhys Ammett here making exactly the same mistake Fifita did for Van der Merwe's try up at Murrayfield, entering the ruck and a Lions storm down the wing. Well, here, the Lions just get genuinely confused by the attack making a mistake in their own shape, and they forget to make what should be an easy, obvious tackle. This is the kind of confusion that will only ever be created when both teams share the same name, and I don't think the Springboks can hold a marketing meeting that fast, so I won't be too worried about this happening again. The Lions have only really had two periods of sustained pressure in four games, and a handful more when the opposition were attacking in earnest. But even in those few scenarios, Gatland and Tandy have played their cards incredibly close to their chest. Just as since the Japan game they've reverted back to the most basic three-man pod rugby on attack, the core pattern on defence is what teams were doing 4 or 5 years ago. Nothing on the cutting edge as we'd expect from some of the best coaches in the world who very much put emphasis on defence. This is clearly tactical. Gatland knows his players are good enough that they can play the most basic rugby that isn't tantamount to throwing the game, and get through to the first test. The Lions are scoring so many simple tries, such as this by Watson, who literally just seems to scream the word FAST and the Sharks defenders fall over, that they don't need to worry so much about the defense. They're four games in, but it's only a tiny amount you, I, or Razzy Rasmussen, Jacques Nienaber can pick up about how they're going to try and contain South Africa. After all, why risk giving the Springboks secret information when just advancing as a Lion can contain 95% of what the opposition is going to throw at you? However, there are a handful. There's a few small things we can take from these games. I'm not completely wasting your time. And let's start with what feels like the most obvious, the biggest one. Because whereas other positions' defensive responsibilities can be nailed and covered just as easily in training as in a match, the positioning of a back three without the ball changes so much based on how the opposition are playing, making it the part of the Lions' defensive game that requires the most practice in match time. Something that's useful to practice in games instead of purely in training sessions hidden away from the praying eyes of Erasmus Industries. One interesting note is that the Lions are generally dropping the number into the backfield on kick return, which is something Warren Gatland never used to do with Wales, where his first instinct was to kick back instead of crashing and attacking. This was something Scotland did a lot in the Six Nations, using a forward to smash it up so Hogg and Russell can stand back and assess the defence as it aligns and then make a decision, only on occasions counter-attacking directly. And when the opposition aren't looking to kick, the Lions wingers are defending very narrow, very far in field, then pushing out towards the touchline. The exact opposite of how the Springboks defend, where the wingers start wide and push infield. Josh Adams might be attracting headline for the, you know, scoring six tries every single time he touches the ball, but the best bit of his game has always been what he does without that ball. His ability on the kick chase is exceptional, but look at this against Japan. He tracks in just enough to sow a seed of doubt so Japan plays short, knowing they won't get outside him, to try and compress the Lions' line, but he's still able to cover and get Fifita close to the touchline. He then superbly spots the clear out is coming from infield, grabs Fifita's shirt and hangs on for dear life, twisting his body in such a way that when Leach hits him, it uses the captain's momentum against him to put his own teammate into touch. Basically, guys, Josh Adams is the best left winger in the world. I'm glad you're finally catching up. This system puts a lot not just on the wingers' rugby intelligence, but their ability to twist and turn, which is a huge mark against the name of Duan van der Merwe, who's having a superb, excellent, very, very good tour so far, but might just not have the maneuverability. He doesn't turn so well to fit into how the Lions are doing it if this is how they're going to continue to defend going forward. And it's not the only spot where the Lions might be exploitable out wide, as the Sharks' one try that didn't come from batshit bullshit may have proven. When near the try line, the Lions currently play a 14-man press, both wingers and the scrum half all being incredibly aggressive in the main line, the fullback alone covering the backfield. However, where that lone man stands is coming from the rest of his back three. He's not making the decision himself. Here we see Josh Adams scream and point at the far wing, and Stuart Hogg then sprints to take position over there, cutting off an overlap. But once Rhys Sammitt inside him makes the tackle, Hogg has to stay on his guard, and Adams is still too far out on his own wing to cover, meaning there's a window of opportunity. Most of the backfield, for a short period, just this one phase, is completely undefended for chip or grubber. The Sigma Lions didn't exploit this, but you can be sure the Sharks did. You can be sure the Sharks did because they've already done it. It's a stupid line I wrote. Similar to Hogg, or apparently half his extra teammates, Liam Williams has taken position on the far right, and Anthony Watson covers in behind instead. He's the guy covering for chips and grubbers until he spots the Sharks have a mini overlap. Watson shouts Sanjay over and goes back to his wing, but this leaves a small area of dead space behind Watson that Williams could never reach in time. This is perfectly weighted by Cronier and finished brilliantly by Abrahams, opening up the line's defence. This whole thing, leaving these dead spaces behind, feels like an educated risk by Gatland. South Africa, simply put, do not kick inside the 22. Even on penalty advantage, they don't try speculative cross kicks or grubbers. They keep grinding away at the line instead, just bashing and bashing and bashing. This, a cheeky grubber out wide by Spion Kosi, who finishes himself in just the second game of the Erasmus regime 3 years ago, is the only time they've kicked inside the 22 that I was able to find from across Razzy Erasmus's full 25 games in charge. They didn't do it once during the World Cup, not even a cross kick. Nothing. Literally nothing. Lions defence coach Steve Tandy said pre-tour his intention was not to bring over the system he'd employed of Scotland, as Andy Farrell and Sean Edwards have done on the last few tours where they've copied and pasted what they were doing with England, Ireland or Wales, but instead to attempt to build a new Frankenstein system from composite bits of the four nations' defensive patterns, creating the world's first kind of Megazord defensive system. But equally, this will be a game plan built to try and contain South Africa, and South Africa only. It'll be built to their weaknesses and strengths. It's a system built as such to deal with a team who never try grubbers for the corner like the one that came from Lionel Cronier, who is such a box of tricks you probably couldn't open the lid because the lid is a trick. Gatland has taken a gamble, and I just want to say, Razzy, if you're watching, You should really watch Frances Ha. It's a joyous slice of Greta Gerwig at her best and a superb introduction to the rest of her career. Really, I'd recommend just taking the next month out to binge all of her movies instead of focusing on the rugby at all. You know, nowhere near enough people talk about Mistress America, so why not be the one to do that in your team talk pre-game? Instead of talking about, like, rugby or something, talk about the 2016 film Wiener Dog. I'm sure the team would appreciate it. I hear Eben Etzebeth is a huge fan of Maggie's Plan, which is a really charming little movie if you can find it. Go and watch it. You should have a chat about that next training session. Just forget about the chip kick thing. Never look at that. Just forget I spoke. Forget I spoke. I never spoke. Greta Gerwig. All that matters for you, Razzie. All that matters. Against Japan, the Lions forwards stood off almost every ruck, the only exceptions being Jack Conan at 8, who, partly because he was so frequently left in the wide channels, found himself against isolated bodies more frequently and was given little more license to attack the ball. However, against the Sharks, the Lions were competing on almost every face, sending someone in to try and grapple and steal constantly. And it was effective. The Lions taking more possession than Satan on his birthday. But against the Lions, they operated somewhere in between. This was probably the longest period of sustained pressure the Tories have had to withstand so far. And to survive it, they gave us perhaps their best image of the Frankenstein defence we've seen. The core system for 14 of the 15, forwards like the ruck and back spread equidistant across the rest of the pitch, is not how Scotland defended the Six Nations, who let stand far tighter than drift. It's probably closer to England or Wales, but the one remaining head-body-mullet combo was employed exactly how Scotland use him. Despite being named a worthy Six Nations Player of the Championship, Hamish Watson made the fewest tackles of any flank who started all five games. This isn't because he's lazy or too small. This is a deliberate tactic in how Townsend and Tandy used him. Now, Hamish Watson hits harder than a cement truck of a black belt, so why were Scotland, and now the Lions, actively trying to limit the number of tackles he was making? There's only two possible explanations, right? One, the Lions know sooner or later the insurance won't cover it if Hamish is hitting like this every week, or two, they don't want him making tackles because he's more use elsewhere. Similar to how the Springboks keep Dwayne Vermeulen away from making tackles to control and marshal other defenders, Tandy likes to keep his seven unoccupied so he can focus on attacking the breakdown instead, trying to turn the ball over. The tactic I'm about to show you was something he actually first implemented as a player, not a coach, at the Ospreys, and has since remained a staple of his right through until its most famous usage here, the time it gave Scotland the match-winning turnover at Twickenham. Watson doesn't stand in the main line with the defence. He waits behind the ruck and drifts behind the tacklers until there's a chance to attack the ball and win it back for his team. He's never dragged into a tackle. He's never the guy making it, but always right nearby to contest the ball without ever needing to come inside the ruck. He's behind it, approaching it from behind every time. The Lions implement it here. After the Lion, oh, the Lion, the other Lion, the other, you know, the, you know which Lions I mean, go for the set piece and do all of this. Watson drifts off the scrum here and crashes his way into the breakdown, trying to disrupt the ball. He slows it a little, but then as the next tackle is made, he doesn't join the line. He waits behind it, stood behind the breakdown. The ball comes out. Mish moves to get himself behind the next set of tacklers. He senses the ball is going wider, so steps into the line, allowing him to once again be in line with the tackle when Harris makes it. He's there to get over the ball and comes very close to turning it over. The ball does go wide, so the Lions defend a few more phases. Watson shuffles over here, so he's near but not opposite the player receiving the ball. Eventually, Mish senses another opportunity. He enters the breakdown and manages to pin the ball in, winning the turnover. Stopping the Springboks isn't something you can do by fluke, and giving Watson such a specific job to do on defence allowed him to both pick his moments and only strike when the turnover is on, but also to be able to assess every opportunity. The Lions always have to have their sharpest turnover challenger nearby if the opportunity comes up. Watson is always primed to pounce, unlike against Japan, where they tried to just challenge with whoever was on hand, and sometimes that would mean weak rucks went untargeted. The box gave you so few opportunities, you have to take every single one of them. And that's where the Tories headed, right? The Lions are currently being granted plenty of opportunities, and they're taking most of them, but it'll be interesting to see if they come closer to their genuine game plan when they play what is now a fully loaded South Africa A this week, or if Gatland, as I kind of expect him to do, runs in the exact opposite direction and hides even more, teetering even closer to that line that says whether or not he's throwing the game. Because the element surprise may just be what they need when it comes to the tests, where they'll need to be utterly ruthless whilst hoping their defence becomes hard to explain because it's complicated, rather than because they never really do it. You joined me literally seconds after I found out Alan Wynne-Jones is rejoining the tour parties. That's very, very exciting. I want to thank you as well for watching that video. I wanted to get one on the attack done, but I think with the way the Springboks A game is looking, I'll probably just skip and look at that. But anyway, there'll be something else coming before the first test in, you know, 10 days' time. So that's very exciting. There's plenty more around the channel. There's more on sort of looking at this from a Springboks point of view elsewhere. There's a video on the Japan game. There's loads of stuff. Like, I did a sort of full half hour on how they might play, and a lot of that looks like it's going to be the case. So yes, there's loads of stuff around the channel. Please have a look, have a thumb around. And in the meantime, let's just luxuriate in Alan being back somehow.
Hey, have you ever done where you, like, play fight?
Why?
Because it's funny, to be funny.
I don't want to.
Oh, it's super fun. So just come at me.
No.
Okay, well then I'll just...
Oh my God, stop it! Damn it!